It's great to be with you today. It's always an honor to share around the Word of God. I just really felt something that's been in my heart lately is the words refire. Refire. I'm not talking about losing your job, that's terrible. I'm talking about something starting again, getting going again. I believe that now that God is calling us to refire as a church to get things going again. I don't know if you've ever been in a situation where you've had to restore something or you've had to fix something that was badly broken. When I was younger, I was involved in a car accident and the car was badly damaged. But my dad was a mechanic and he said, hey, we can fix this. Other people wanted to write the car off, but he said, no, there's still a future for it. And so we went to the drawing board. We looked at some photographs of it and some diagrams of it. They had to try and reshape the car back to its original design. And by the grace of God and some serious skills from my dad, that car went on to be a great car for many years to come. And if we want to refire the church, we're going to have to take a look at the original design and the original intent that God had for it. You might say, hey, the church hasn't stopped. We've been watching online. That's true. But the other truth is that Jesus said, I will build my church and the gates of hell won't prevail against it. That word church that he used there in its original language, it literally means a group of people gathered together, assembled together for a purpose. And so without the gathering, the church isn't really functioning. The good news is it doesn't have to be a lot of gathering. It can just be two or three. Jesus is happy with that. If there's two or three gathered in my name, he said, there I am in the midst. And so God is getting things going again. He's getting things refired again. You know, there's actually a powerful spiritual significance to gathering. Sometimes we miss this. Sometimes we think, oh, we're so spiritual, we don't need to go to church, or we're so spiritual, we don't need other Christians. The truth of the matter is that gathering is one of the most spiritual things that we can do. And as we look at the book of Acts, we see that God started the church with a gathering. In Acts chapter 2, I was reading this not so long ago, and I was shocked at so many of the similarities that they were facing that we've also been facing as well. In Acts chapter 2, verse 1 to 4, we're going to read it together. It says, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. It filled the whole house where they were sitting. And there appeared with them divided tongues as of fire. And one sat on every single one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And today we're going to take a quick look at this and see the truths that set the early church on fire so that we can get reset on fire again today. Amen. Come on, I can hear you say amen. Amen. All right, praise God. The first thing that jumps out at me is that they were waiting. It says when the day of Pentecost had fully come. In other words, they had been waiting for that day. They were in a waiting season. They were waiting around. How many days? Well, actually 10 days. Jesus said, go and wait for me in Jerusalem and then the Holy Spirit, the promise of the Father, will come. Isn't that incredible? The church started with waiting. And so it makes sense that the church will be refired again. It will be reignited again in a season of waiting. You know, waiting can be wasted depending on who or what you're waiting for. I don't know about you, but I don't really like waiting. But as we wait for things to open, maybe you're waiting for government restrictions to lift, for university to go back. I don't know what it is. But we can turn our waiting around into waiting on God and not waste this time. There's something so powerful about waiting on God. You know, I think that maybe a lot of us as believers have forgotten this practice of waiting on the Lord. But it's the thing that started the early church. The early church started with waiting. That's what Jesus said in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. So go and wait for me in Jerusalem. Go and wait there until the Holy Spirit comes. And when he comes, he will give you power to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and unto the ends of the earth. And I've learned to love waiting in this time. It's just renewed my passion for waiting on God. A few weeks ago, I was just listening to some messages about waiting on the Lord. And I thought, you know, I pray and, you know, I spend time with God and I spend time reading the Bible. But I just thought, you know, I'm just going to wait for God. I'm just going to wait on God. And I just sat there and put some worship music on and said, God, I'm waiting for you. Would you come and fill this place? Would you come and fill this space? I want to tell you today that God's presence came into that room, that I felt the presence of God so strongly that it didn't leave me the entire day. I didn't even want to leave the room because God's presence was so tangible and it was so powerful. There's something so powerful about waiting on God. As we look to the book of Isaiah, Isaiah was a man that prophesied about Jesus more accurately than just about anyone else in Scripture. And he also was someone that knew the art of waiting on God. He said in Isaiah 8:17, "I will wait on the Lord. He who hides his face from the house of Jacob, I will hope in him." And then again in Isaiah 40:31, he said, "Those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They'll mount up with wings like eagles. They'll run and not be weary. They'll walk and not faint." You know, we know how to wait for things, but we can't just be willing to wait for things and not wait on God. You know, in Perth recently, when things were really going crazy, people were lining up waiting for toilet paper. I know, it's crazy, right? I've seen people sleep out and camp out at night waiting for the latest iPhone or the latest iPad to be released, sleeping out in a shopping center. We're okay with waiting, but how much more should we wait on God? How much power is there in waiting on the Lord? And if we turn this waiting around time into a waiting on God time, some incredible things will start to happen. You know, even today after this service, you can start to wait on God. You can start to pray for one another. You can take communion together. That's what we've been doing after the service, just praying for one another and laying hands on one another. We can continue to wait on God in this season so that it's not wasted. Somebody say, amen. Amen. The second thing that jumps out at me is that they were together. Say together. They were together. They were all with one accord in one place. We touched on this just a moment ago, but it's so significant. It's so important that we gather together. The church isn't really the church without gathering. The church isn't really what God called it to be without us meeting together. And Jesus made it super simple, super clear. It doesn't have to be with a lot of people. It can be with one or two. There He is in the midst, but we have to gather together. If you think about it, this small gathering of a few people, just over 100 people, that birthed the worldwide church that saw that city and that region and the world turned upside down. Even if you think about Azusa Street, the great Azusa Street revival, it started just as a gathering. See, God uses the foolish things of this world to confound the wise, and He uses us gathering together to change the world. That's also how Kingdom City started. It started as a gathering of people together in a small room, in a small place, and incredible things happened. You know, it was the week before lockdown, and we were getting ready for church, and I went to church that morning. Actually, I was preaching in one of our campuses here in Perth. And towards the end, I just felt such a strong encouragement from God from Hebrews 10:25, where the writer of Hebrews talks about, do not forsake the gathering together, as some have done. And I shared that right at the end and really felt God was on it and saying, you know, let's not forsake gathering together. I was a bit confused because that very week, church shut down. We weren't able to meet anymore. And I was thinking, God, did I not hear you right? Did I not hear what you were saying? But as time went on, I realized more and more that He wasn't asking us to break the law or to keep going into the building when the government was saying not to. No, no, He was just saying to do this. Hey, make sure you're gathering together. Make sure you're watching the service together. Make sure you're praying together with other believers. And as we pray together, as we worship together, there He is right there in the midst. I remember the very first week we could, we invited another family over to watch the service with us. It was tangible. It was powerful, the presence of God that came into that room as we worshiped Him together. Just even last week, we were worshiping with a few Connect groups that met together here in Perth. And it was incredible as we were worshiping together. There was such a touch of the presence of God in that place. This got me thinking, why is it that when we get together that God's presence comes? What is it about that? Is it because of the building that we're in? Is it because of the space we're in? No, they weren't in a good building. In fact, there was other buildings that were better. There was the temple in that city. Can you imagine that? The Holy Spirit came to the upper room, but He didn't go to the temple. There was lots of upper rooms in Jerusalem at that time. but it was the fact that they had gathered together. Because if I'm the temple of the Holy Spirit, if you're the temple of the Holy Spirit, and we get together and we worship together, there's more temples worshiping God in that place. There's more of God in that room. And that's why the presence of God is felt so strongly as we worship together. And it's so important that as things open up, as things change, that we do not forsake gathering together, that we start to engage again, worshiping God in one accord. Amen. Amen. Let's not waste this season. Let's make sure that we are gathering and worshiping the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords together. The third thing that jumps out at me, and this might be obvious to you, but it just really struck out at me, is that they were in a house. They're in the upper room of a house. It wasn't the upper room of a convention center. It wasn't the upper room of Sunway. It wasn't the upper room of some shopping mall. They were worshiping in somebody's house. The church started in a house. And so it makes sense that for God to reignite the church, for God to refire us as a church, it's going to start in homes. It's going to start house to house. And house to house is how the church was birthed around the world. House to house, if you look at it actually at Azusa Street, it actually first started in a house before it went to Azusa Street as well. And if you even think about Kingdom City, what God has done here, it started in a house. Pastor Mark with some strangers and some noodles and Jai with his bongos having a great time. It started in a house. And so for God to reignite us, for God to refire us, it's going to start in a house. Pastor Mark made a brilliant point last week during our service. He said that if we actually had our prayers answered and if revival actually did come, we wouldn't have enough buildings to house everybody. We wouldn't even have enough stadiums in any city around the world that we're in to house everybody. He said, but we would have enough houses because we've already got the houses. And that's so true that there is enough houses, and God needs your house today. God needs our house today. This started in one house, but it spread to many houses. And in this next season, we're going from a few locations around the world to thousands of houses. And God is adding this to us, and it's not going to be taken away. From this day forward, Kingdom City is a house church. I never thought I'd say it. I belong to a house church. You belong to a house church. Because even when we go back to our regular services, even when all the restrictions are gone, we still need house to house. We still need our connect groups. That's where discipleship happens. That's where growth happens. That's where real connection happens. You might be saying, Pastor Ben, I can't meet in house to house. There's no way for me to go. Maybe the restrictions are too tight, or maybe, you know, you're actually concerned there's a breakout in your area. Well, you know what? You can Zoom people. You can watch the service and Zoom together. You can even get on WhatsApp. I know, you know, we love WhatsApp here at Kingdom City. We're always creating WhatsApp chats. I love creating WhatsApp chats. You know, we can worship together even through video chat and engage with one another and gather together where there really is no way. But think about it. This is the situation they were in. They were fearful. They weren't sure that if they went to the temple that Jesus had just been crucified, what would happen to them? But they still gathered anyway. And where it's safe and where it's wise, let's gather together. Even if it's just one or two, let's gather together to worship God. Amen. House to house is going to stay with us, and the Lord has need of your house. The fourth thing that jumps out on me here is that they were all set on fire. They were all set on fire. It wasn't just one person, but all 120 of them that were in that upper room, the fire went on every single one of them. And you know, we've been talking a lot about things spreading, and spreading is always in the news. But you know what else spreads? Is fire spreads. And when the fire of God spreads, that can be a good thing. When the presence of God spreads, that can be a good thing. When revival spreads, that can be a good thing. And in this time, we're believing that the fire of God would jump on us and then jump off of us to those that are around us. You know, after this incredible encounter that they had, Peter literally just walked out the front door, and 3,000 people gave their lives to God in one sermon, in one moment. Talk about the fire spreading. Come on, the fire can spread. It started in one house, but it spread to thousands of houses all over the city that were having people over and breaking bread together. Revival started in one place, but it spread to every single other place. They let it go out from them. I love in Acts chapter 2, verse 47, it says, the Lord added to the church daily those that were being saved. Isn't that incredible? God was adding daily to them. Think about that for a moment. They weren't even waiting for the altar call at church on the weekend after the service. They were just doing it right there in the street, in their homes, inviting people over, and they were getting saved. Why? Because revival was spreading out. They'd all been set on fire, and now it was catching over to others. You know, in this time, God's restoring evangelism to us. We're seeing neighbors come to the Lord. We're seeing family members come to know Him. People are inviting their friends and their family. We've been doing it as well. People are getting saved in connect groups. We're having people from other religions come to connects and get radically transformed and saved, even baptized in this time as well. God is on the move and He's restoring evangelism to us, and He's wanting to gather us to scatter us. See, God doesn't just gather us together for our own sake. He gathers us together to scatter us and send us out all over the place, all over the world. And I love what started in one house, in one upper room in Jerusalem, in this time and in this season, spread out to thousands of other houses, thousands of other homes, and even went across to other cities and other regions all over the world. We have to let God set us on fire in this season and let that fire spread out and go out. Amen.